You open the door. You see the cat and the bottle of accelerant dripping onto the counter. You also see the precariously leaning lit candle. Roll for saves. This is Roll for Saves Episode 1, and I think today we're just going to do some introductions. So first, to introduce myself, my name is Wayne. I'm an American expat, and I like role-playing games. Specifically, I like the organization of information, the procedures, and the mechanics of games. So naturally, I like to dabble in designing my own systems. Roll for Saves is the name of the most current system I've been designing. And don't worry, I have nothing famous, so don't expect me to plug anything here. But I'd like to say that this system, Roll for Saves, is about 60% finished. It's also the name of the YouTube channel, podcast, the Blogspot blog. However you found this, I gave them all the same name. Links should be available wherever you're reading this or hearing it or watching it. So specifically the show of Roll for Save is going to be a solo actual play of the system, kind of as a beta test, stress test of it. The show is going to be talking about the mechanics, my reasoning for them, and also my inspiration of them. You can also I'm going to be exploring all of that through a story, hopefully. And if you're watching it on YouTube, you'll be able to see the documentation for everything. However, the text might be small on it, so I suggest watching it on a larger screen if that's what you're interested in. The podcast is going to be the same audio as the YouTube channel, but I'll probably throw some stock music provided by Anchor FM into the background of it. So what's going to make this different than other actual plays is that it's not going to be scripted at all. Some of the actual plays I know they do a little bit of background scripting before the play, even the solo actual plays. Like the combats are largely as they appear on screen, so to speak, but a lot of the other narration was worked out ahead of time, and that's why the voices, the talking heads, the people, the actors, they don't have so much hesitation. They don't have to think about what's happening. They don't have to interpret the results. They already have an idea what's going to happen anyways. So this is just going to be straight from the hip. Whatever happens is what happens. So there's going to be a lot of hemming and hawing, ooms and ahs as I try to work through whatever happens on the screen. Also, like I said, you're going to hear some of the game design process. So if that's what you're into, you're at the right place. So let's get into the design just a little bit. Roll for Saves is probably more of an NSR system. So if you're in a game design, that's you might recognize that NSR, also new OSR, as they call it. So this is going to be a simple, streamlined, and abstract system. The mechanics begin with a D6, and you begin with a D6, and then if the dice would be stepped up whenever you would have a skill that applies or a background that would apply, or something would make the roll easy. So that's three ways to increase your die size. So that means it can go up to a D12. And then if something would make the roll hard, it'll go down one step. So that gives you a minimum of a D4 and a maximum of a D12. On any roll, if you get a four or higher, you pass the roll. It's that simple. So four or higher, and you're safe. In the game, I'm referring to the rolls as saves because anytime I'm rolling for a character, I'm not looking to see if they pass or fail their action. Instead, I'm going to be looking for whether or not they suffer a consequence due to their action. Part of the consequence may be failure of the action, but not necessarily. So that's why I'm referring to everything as saves, hence the name Roll for Saves. What else do we need to talk about? There's going to be a lot of other rules for supplies, rules for magic and initiative and combat, but we'll get into that when we deal with them in in game. So I guess let's get into the setting a little bit. This is going to be a magical world, and right now I'm calling the world Lur, Lurr, maybe pronounced Lore. In this world, there are pretty much only humans. And this is just for my own sanity because I hate it whenever I need to make an NPC. I'm like, okay, are they a dwarf? Are they an elf? And roll on that. And okay, why is there a dwarf here? And, I don't want to have to deal with that on screen. So for right now, everyone's humans, but humans from some areas may be more elf-like, while people from another area may be more dwarf-like or gnome-like, depending on their environment and culture. In this world, magic, weak magic is everywhere. Strong magic is very rare. Even the most remotest of villages will have one or two people that can perform a spell or two. I'd say probably about 25% of the population can cast at least a weak spell. But they aren't like world bending spells. It's just like a minor lasting for, a few seconds effect. And most people probably never even try to cast a spell, so they don't even know if they can or not. Additionally, the failing to properly channel the magical energies can result in mutations of the magic user. So in some societies, the people with the most powerful spells become the leaders. But in other places, because the mutations and the danger that it presents, they're shunned and maybe even outlawed. So until recently, for the geography, the humans have lived kind of dispersed onto island chains. Between the island chains, between the archipelagos, is a vast, open, deep ocean. They call the abyss, the abyssal ocean, which is inhabited by vicious, hunting leviathans, and they would be drawn to ships trying to cross it, and they would attack the ships and sink the ships, making it very dangerous to cross between the archipelagos. This left them fairly isolated. But recently, the people of the land of Nob, they worked out how to easily create electricity. And then they used this. That being isolated, they were able to develop this on their own for a long time, and they eventually came up with airships. And this, with their technological advantages, helped them grow an empire. They went to various island chains, started colonizing. Their empire is now starting to collapse because there's been a discovery of a large continent to the east, and this is the largest landmass that anyone has ever seen. And so right now, all sorts of factions, different companies, secret societies, nations, individuals, they're all running to this new land to scrap over the just the resources, the wealth, the artifacts that they can find, that sort of thing. So as I mentioned, there are artifacts. I guess I'll get into electricity first. The electricity comes from what's called a Firthstein. And these are, to describe in our term, spherical geodes. If you're cracking it open, the crystals would appear kind of opalescent. But these Firth stones are round geodes, often just laying on the ground. And they're scattered across the world. And many mythologies actually have like deities sacrificing themselves, being broken into pieces, or deities scattering them for humans to find. And on their own, these Firthstein, they would glow and emit a white light. So many people, have them to use as lamps and such at night. But the people of Nob, the Noblins, they realize that if they can carefully drill a hole on opposing poles of the stone and then thread a conductive wire through the center, the very center of the stone, the very center of the sphere, that it would present, the wire would then begin to have a current running through it. And this was the electricity. And depending on the size of the stone and the brilliance of the stone, they can tell whether it's going to be a weak voltage or a higher voltage. And by linking many of the stones together, they can actually amplify the voltage exponentially. So, one stone maybe has a power of two, but if you have two stones together, it's going to double that to be four. And then if you have a third stone, then it's going to double it again to be eight. So it just keeps getting stronger and stronger, which is how they power the airships by having these massive chains of Furthstein linked together to, number one, create like a kind of a magnetic anti-gravity field that allows it to allows the ships to levitate a few meters over the ground, and then also to power. And then some of them now have fans, but the older ones, the ones that are most common, they use sails still to maneuver the ships over the surface. So the artifacts that the people are searching for, these are coming from the lost people, progenitors, you might call them. And these people were an advanced civilization, but no one knows what happened to them. There's no records of them, no writings of them. But people do find the tall towers and the deep catacombs that they left, as well as technologies. And before, these devices were just kind of mysterious artifacts. People would kind of try to guess what they were used for, recreate uses for them. But now that there's electricity, they're realizing, oh, they needed power. So these artifacts are providing power, or once provided power, can basically recreate magical spells. And this gives someone that doesn't necessarily have a spell-focused character, someone that has like innate spells or wants to study spells or something like that, they can pick up these items and have like, a powered sword or powered gauntlets to give them strength, something of that nature. So it's just little things to increase character power. So in the story, we're going to be probably having a character in the land of Lur, going into the largest, most populous city there, which is technically under the rule of the Noblins, but is currently undergoing a lot of unrest, looking at a revolution. And then, so there's going to be, chance for factions and fighting. Also, because it's out on this frontier, there's going to be chance for exploration and wonders as well. And we'll just have to see how it goes. All right. Well, I think that's going to do it for episode one. If you want to read more about the game and recaps of the sessions, you can go to rollforsaves.blogspot.com. Again, the podcast is at Anchor FM. I believe it's slash roll for saves, anchor.fm/rollforsaves. Patreon is patreon.com/rollforsaves, and YouTube, they're currently in the middle of rolling out handles, so I don't have a good URL for you because right now it's just a bunch of gibberish. But we'll see how that comes out when it comes out. But if you can't find it on YouTube because there's not enough viewers or anything to bring it up to the top of the search, you can follow the links in descriptions and on the blog and such to find it. All right. That's going to do us for today. Have fun gaming and good luck.